Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another First Friday event. This evening, I am prepared for the conditions since we're dealing with the Arctic. I'm here in Greenland, a remote location here for the town of Woodside, the First Friday event. This evening, we are very lucky and fortunate to have Dr. Leslie Fields, who is a really amazing individual. When you think, this is a mom, this is an artist, this is a singer, and this is also a scientist who is doing her part, stepping into to try to change the conditions of the environment and what is happening there. It's an amazing story that will be out here shortly. And before we begin, there are a lot of people who are concerned about climate change, and there are those who don't feel necessary that it's a reality. But I'd like to remind us of what James Hansen, who is a climate scientist, began talking about this back to Congress in 1988. So it's been a very long time that this process has been happening. And he felt so strongly about it. He said that he has been described as the grandfather of climate change. In fact, he says, I am just a grandfather, and I do not want my grandchildren to say that grandpa understood what was happening but didn't make it clear. So I think after this evening's presentation with Dr. Leslie Fields, that you will hopefully feel a little clearer about what's happening in the Arctic, an amazing environment. I was fortunate enough to spend quite a bit of time there living in Barrow, exciting, beautiful place, but a place that is experiencing a lot of change due to climate change. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Dr. Leslie Fields to begin with us.
So hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you. I'm sure hopefully everyone else can as well.
All right, good. Well, I am very thrilled to be here today. And let me start sharing my screen and let you know a little bit about why the Arctic matters and what ICE 911 research is doing about it and a bit of my personal story as I've been asked to share as well. So let's see, I have got this on, and I think it should be sharing that, but maybe not. Can you see my screen yet? Oh yes, good. And
yes.
Let me see if I can also get it to do the whole, it's a little bit tricky to get it to do presentation mode in this. Here we go. Yes, I think we're going to get there. Does that do it? Does that do it? Slideshow from the beginning. There we are. I think we're set. Can you see this at full screen now? Tom?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, we can.
Okay. Great. So hello, I've been looking forward to this for a long time, actually. We've had to cancel for COVID. and my cough need not alarm you because we're all virtual. And here we go. I would like to, because it's very odd to be speaking to an audience where I can't see anybody's faces, I want to stop a few times for questions. And so I think this will help us make sure that I'm on track with what you care about and that this doesn't feel like it's dragging on at all. So I'm going to put this in a few things. I've been asked, although most of the advertising about this is that it's about the Arctic and that it's about ICE 911 research, so why the Arctic matters in that. I've also been told that you want to hear my personal story. So we're going to start with that. We're going to say why I started this work, who I am, and then we'll get into why the art, and ask me a question or two. And then why the, which come in through the chat, I believe. And then why the Arctic matters, and then what our solution is, and then what's our shared future, and questions, questions everywhere. And I passionately believe what I see, what I'm showing you on the bottom of this slide and a couple more slides as we go along, every degree really does matter, and every degree is worth fighting for. This is how I felt when I first got it, that climate change was going to be an urgent problem in my own kids' lifetimes. I felt like I'd been run over by a Mack truck. It was not a pleasant feeling. And it was like I was the thing standing between that truck and my innocent little kid. All of this is clip art. We've improved our graphics since then, but this is how I felt. And why I started this work is obviously very personal. It's about my own kids. As Tom mentioned, I do love doing art, and so here's my kids when they were little. And here they are photographically. My brother's also a newspaper photographer, so he caught this shot. And, you know, it was thinking about that devastation and thinking about their futures. It was like, good grief, what can I do? I was fortunate in some of my R&D work over the years at HP Labs that I was mentored by Barb Waugh, who really taught several of us this wonderful thing to live by, which is these words to live by, which is, if not me, who? If not now, when? And that really helped power me on to start this work. These little dudes you just saw here have become quite a bit bigger, and this even is a few years ago. So all grown up, but still caring very much about their futures. I also care about nature a lot. I've always been one of those people who is happiest hiking around outdoors, doing art, that sort of thing. And this is my wildflower garden before this year's drought really, really caught up with it. A wonderful day in Yosemite, taking one of the conservancy's art classes and getting to have an excuse to sit there and paint beautiful half dome. And this is sunrises from our place and our cats. You know, there's a lot to try to save this planet and ecosystem for. It also turns out when my kids were in school, I loved volunteering in their classrooms. And I had this program for 8 years running called Noon Art for kindergarten through third graders. And I just the other day got a letter from, it's the first one I've gotten of this kind, but from one of my old students, not pictured here, but just said, you know, basically he was telling me that his first interactions with me might have been at Noon Art, and I was the first adult who was giving him any encouragement at all about his art, and he was having trouble fitting into a school that was new to him. So he's just graduated college with a master's degree, and he took the time to write back to me to thank me for that. And that sort of thing touches your heart and continues you in thinking you've really got to teach. I've also been teaching, this will be my 11th year this fall, this class at Stanford that I started up, again, to try to help battle climate change, thinking, well, if I can teach some students what they could do to help things, maybe that would go a long way. And you are all invited if you want to come. Stanford has never made me turn away an auditor. It's open to graduate and undergrad students, and it's a broad enough, interdisciplinary enough class in engineering, entrepreneurship, and climate change that we speak in English rather than technicalese, and the students really seem to love it. And so I invite you to come do this if you want. You can find this in the Stanford catalog under this class number. Classes start the week of September 14th. Our class will once again be Tuesdays, so that means we start September 15th. You're welcome to come to one or all of them. And in fact, some of your Woodside residents have been regular speakers in this class. I've been thrilled. One of the names you'll certainly recognize is who I call the real co-founders of Tesla. At least two out of three of the real co-founders of Tesla have appeared a few times in my class, Mark Tarpening and Martin Eberhard. And their discussion of how they got things started and just what all the calculations on that and the partnership is just inspiring. So join us if you want. But one thing I also tell the students and really believe passionately, if we're going to try to intervene in climate at all, let's make sure we're carefully trying something. This is a fragile planet. The billions of us are having quite an effect on it. And it's really, we're duty bound to be careful about what we propose. So that was about, you know, why on earth I started something. It's, I care a lot about my kids, my family, the environment, and people in general. Who am I? Well, here's one of the earliest pictures of me I know about that indicates maybe I would become an engineer. And so I rather like that one, up in my grandmother's house in Maine. And here's a painting I did right before I went off to college at MIT. So I've always had those sides of the brain enjoying life. And in fact, it's probably because my mom's an artist and my dad's an engineer. I was the first woman to do a lot of things. So in my time at MIT, I was one of 10% undergraduates who were women. This is my, we just came across this recently. This is my unfortunately recently deceased, just within the last week or so, PhD advisor at Berkeley for my PhD in electrical engineering, specializing in MEMS. And this is when I was receiving my PhD, and I was the first woman graduate out of that particular center at Berkeley, the Berkeley Sensor and Actuator Center. So it can be a lonely life in some ways, right? You don't quite fit the stereotypes. It can be a wonderful life. You can see we had a very nice relationship. He was a good advisor and just an excellent human being, and that was a good experience. And it makes you determined to be one of few who are like you. It makes you determined, which I suspect has helped me take on climate change, which is a tough thing. I've also finding that it seems I'm pretty resilient. So, you know, our youngest son, who is my backpacking buddy, and we do an annual trip, mother-son trip, every summer for the last few years, couldn't do it this year. We were concerned about bringing COVID home to fragile family members here. And it was like there just was no safe way. So after he got bored with neighborhood hikes, I started this idea of let's try, and we schemed it together, let's backpack in place. And there was a Portola Valley, I live in Portola Valley, had a pandemic literary contest. And I had time to put together 17 syllables. And they gave an honorable mention for that, you know, 10-mile hike with son, backpack in place from front door, no breath, few words. Wow. And I've got to say, you folks, probably most of your attendees are from Woodside, given that this is a Woodside event. This double whammy, right, of the coronavirus pandemic and all the smoke and wildfire danger and the threat of having to evacuate, it's really been something. And it's a time to really count the blessings that you still have and, you know, just bond together as much as we possibly can. We are truly in this together. And you can have some fun, right? This was kayaking in place. We put in an above ground pool years ago for our kids. It's the only polar bear I'm going to see this season. A neighbor gave me that years ago. So this is sort of what you do if you're lucky enough to have been. This weekend, we will be celebrating having lived in this house high up on a hill, you know, halfway up to skyline for 28 years. So that's enough about me for now. And I thought I would open this up to questions. Are there any questions that have come in, Tom? I think Tom's the watcher of questions.
No questions at this time. Just remember, folks, you can type in the chat and your questions can be seen there. But right now, the only question that's kind of looking at, somebody has asked, why the Arctic?
Thank you. You're exactly the person we need in the audience, because that's what comes next. I have noticed there is one sent to me privately. Did the recent fires affect our house? As you can see, I may be a little behind on my pruning. Actually, we're quite a bit more pruned than we were when we took this picture that you're seeing here. But been doing a lot of passionate fire mitigation here, but we've been lucky so far. So, knock on wood. Okay, so moving on to why the Arctic. The Arctic, as it turns out, is an incredibly important lever on climate change. And the fact that, here's a Professor Peter Wadhams is one of the longest standing, most prominent, one of a couple of the most prominent experts on the Arctic and the polar regions in the world. And what he's been saying lately, the last several years, is that the overall change in ice snow albedo in the Arctic could add as much as 50% to the direct global heating effect of CO2. That is, as much as we're heating our atmosphere, increasing global warming, global temperature rise, by having changed the composition of our atmosphere, we're adding another half again as much due to the loss of reflectivity in the Arctic. Now, in this case, the 50% counts in both the loss in sea ice reflectivity, or sea ice at all, and the loss of land ice reflectivity. As glaciers melt, we're getting more dirt showing and more rocks at the edges showing, that sort of thing. And the melt ponds themselves are less reflective than, the intact ice and snow have been. This is a huge change. And the reason that this happens is because if you think about it, we've effectively changed having a white t-shirt on the Arctic, basically the heat shield that the Arctic has had for millions of years, as far as we can look back, that is the case. And we have changed, well, or at least for millions of years, and we have now replaced that with what's effectively a dark t-shirt. White reflective ice, snow are extremely reflective. Multi-year ice is very, very reflective, almost as reflective as snow. It's like you can't do better than fresh snow, it seems. And open ocean absorbs almost all the energy that's coming in. And so in the summer, when you've got 24-hour a day sunlight and that energy pounding down from space on us, instead of having a lot of ice and snow to reflect that back, we've got open ocean saying, okay, warm me up. And that's not so good for the Earth's temperature. In fact, I've seen a series of these videos over the years that I've been doing this. They've really been impactful for me. And this is the best one I've seen yet. It's a fairly recent one NASA put together. It's 2 minutes, it's worth the trip. And before I start it, you'll notice that you're looking down. Here's the Central Arctic that has been the Beaufort Gyre that has been the repository of most of the sea ice, bright multi-year reflective ice in the world. You'll see Greenland. You'll see a region called the Fram Strait. You'll see Point Barrow. Here's where we have experimented up in the Arctic, several years on lake ice. And you will see that you can monitor sea ice over 4 years old here. It'll go back and forth as time clicks along. What the sea ice age is, it goes with the brightness. Okay, so if it's an open ocean, very dark, first year sea ice, a little bit light, multi-year ice has had time to have all kinds of inclusions and thickness and, imperfections. It gets brighter because of all those interruptions in the optical path. So if you're watching here, you'll see month and year will go by. And let's start this thing. It starts kind of slow. And what you notice is we're still lucky enough here, 1985, that we reform ice every winter, at least some. But because we've lost more and more of our multi-year ice, more and more the ice that gets to form every winter is first-year ice. And it doesn't have time, you can probably notice as you're looking here, to grow up and become multi-year ice anymore. And you can see an enormous export of ice through the Fram Strait between Greenland and Svalbard. So this is not good news. And we'll keep on watching. I think this goes till 2019. It goes a little slow now. Here, I'll give you the spoiler. It goes really quickly in a little bit. And one of the best things I can do, I think, is be quiet and let you watch that. Right about now, it's going to get utterly shocking. What you see is no natural way back. This isn't some short-term weather, you know, fluctuation. This is a relentless march. So that sort of thing has at times made me cry. It's not good for us. And you can see the juxtaposition here then of this, let's get my pictures back out of the way, of the beginning of that sequence and where we are now. And this has made, as I have said, a very large impact on our rate of global temperature rise. Dr. Don Perovich, another one of the world's, the other really, of the world's great longtime ice experts, has talked about, you know, back in 85, old ice comprised about 30% of Arctic sea ice cover. So that's that bright stuff. Now it's about 1%. If you follow this sort of thing, NOAA's Arctic report card of 2018 was pretty shocking, and 2019 continued the shocking trend. This is not good news. So we have a mission. And our mission is to restore Arctic reflectivity. And the reason is that without doing that, without stabilizing the ice by possibly 2030, since 2030 is one of the more and more predicted dates by which we will be completely ice-free in the summer in the Arctic, that we have a really nature-imposed deadline to get the job done in order to have a prayer of holding to the 2 degree C limits that the IPCC are recommending, or even better, the 1.5, but you know, to have a chance at 2 degrees, we need to get this done quickly and to achieve any or most of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So we really, the planet is in our hands, and we have this sort of five-part technical work that we are diligently working on. I started this thing in 2006 as initial work. 2008, I incorporated. I've been working, you'll see some field testing pictures in a couple minutes, you know, diligently throughout. And it's been gratifying that it has turned from I into we, a growingly powerful team and collaborations, which gives us hope that we can actually get this job done. But we really have a planet to take care of. Climate modelers who we work with show that if we were to do a global deployment of what I'm going to describe shortly of what our solution is, we could have a difference of having ice in the Arctic of this on the right versus this on the left after some years of deployment. I think this was from 40 years from the peer-reviewed published paper we've had back in 2018. And the consequences of not, you know, I've learned not to dwell on this too much, but certainly to put it out there. Without this, we have millions, I've even seen an estimate of a couple billion climate refugees by the time we're done with this, which is just unimaginable, with all the human suffering that that would mean, right? All the wildfires that we're experiencing personally around here in California, people having to just walk away from where they've lived forever because they don't have enough water to grow their crops, and these horrific storms. This is not the world you wish for your children. And if we don't succeed, if you care more about the financial impact of it, which is certainly relevant when you think about how on earth could we pay for an intervention of any sort, you know, we're already being cost billions of dollars in the US alone. Just in 2018, This was just under $100 billion, just the combined impact of all of these climate disasters. Now, what we don't pretend, what we don't believe, what we'll never say is that we're the only thing you need to do, because we're not. Remember, what we're doing is we're accelerating the rate of global temperature rise that's happening because, in the first place, of greenhouse gases that have accumulated and changed our atmospheric composition. If we were just to do ice restoration and neglect to do anything about, you know, decarbonizing the atmosphere and the economy, eventually we'd still melt out all the ice. Eventually we'd still, temperature would keep rising. What this has been meant to do, what I meant this to do when I started it, was to slow the rate of global temperature rise so we'd have time. Because what I learned at Stanford once I started really getting concerned about this, I learned that it takes decades to turn over the infrastructure for the kind of carbon-heavy industry that we have worldwide, decades. And I thought, my goodness, we don't even seem to be getting a real start on it yet. By the time we really do it, you know, by the time we try hard on that, it'll still take a long time to turn that over, you know, at least a decade or two if we went as fast as we could. And therefore, we need some climate interventions in the meantime to slow things down enough to get that done without so much devastation. But if you're going to mess with climate, you really want to go carefully into that. You do not want to do something that's a global modification that you can't undo. What I've always wanted to do is local, reversible, and watch for any unintended consequences. Tom and audience, I'm going to ask you now, I have some other supplementary slides for this section, or we could go on to our solution. We could stop here for questions on the importance of the Arctic. I will say, while you're thinking, if you have questions, one thing that's very interesting to know is that when you think about looking at the atmosphere and you're saying, I wonder if we're at 300 ppm CO2 today or 400 or more, you can't tell, right? You have to trust scientists and their measurement equipment and such, you know, and trust science itself to tell you how many ppm CO2 in the atmosphere do we have? Does it matter? But when you're looking at the Arctic, this is something visible, and it's something that people more and more seem to be getting. As yet another polar expert, we do seek out the polar experts, Dr. Lars Smedsrud has been pointing out, this is one of the most visible signs of climate change. It's really helping the world get it. It's this horrible lever on driving climate change more, but the opportunity is we can help drive it the other way. So should I stop for questions or go on to how we're solving this?
I do have a question that's come in, and that is, are most countries supportive and participating, or are there some that aren't?
yeah, that's such a good question. The world has not completely lined up here. If you're saying specifically the Arctic, I will say that I've had the pleasure of getting to speak, the adventures I never thought I'd have. Getting to speak in front of the UN at their first climate restoration panel last year, and getting to speak at the Arctic Circle Assembly 2 years in a row. And that's an impactful meeting that happens. The ones that I've gone to have been in Reykjavik, Iceland, and it's run, it was founded by former President Grimson, and a brilliant man and just a geopolitical genius. And he's intentionally got people gathered there to discuss the future of the Arctic. And the first time I spoke there, I was really surprised to hear, before I spoke, people getting up there to say, the Arctic is melting. You know, these world leaders of various nations that face the Arctic-facing nations. And they're saying, the Arctic is melting. And I'm thinking, oh, God, I know. And they're saying, you know, essentially, in a loose terms, they're saying, yippee, we've got more access to oil and minerals now. And it took me a while to swallow why that would be. Because, you know, yes, it's good for short-term benefit economically, and I can see that if your populace is unemployed or underemployed, starving, worried about whether their kids will have enough to eat or or careers, you know, as they're getting ready for them, then you're going to be very concerned about that. But if you look a few years further out, you know, this is helping to accelerate basically the demise of the world's ecosystems. And so that was very shocking to me. I think President Grimson invited me back to have a panel or two and a plenary talk the following year, last year, because he knew that what I'd be talking about would help people understand more of those long-term consequences. And so he, for one, is very supportive of, you know, trying to help us make all the contacts we can. Some nations really are on board and some are not. It reminds me a little bit of having a teenager, you know, graduating high school or getting close to it, and having the conversations with them about long-term happiness versus short-term happiness. It's only in this case, you know, if my kids were going to starve tomorrow, I would worry about food on the table even before I would worry about climate change. I think that's true. So this is hard things. These are very hard things. So we could go through, you know, why every degree of temperature rise matters. Or if you guys want to hear more about this later, these are some of the early thinkings that I had as I was trying to figure out what would make sense. I do like the idea of something that you can do and undo and reverse so that you can actually tune it into just right, rather than have something go out of control, either too hot or too cold. This was some of my early visioning of what I was going to do. This was some of our early, this was our board, our original board. So those were the optional materials. You just got the fly through. But this is the solution. I guess I'd better turn my pictures back on so I can see if you can see the material when I do it. Basically, this is what I call the magic slide because it shows you what we're trying to do. You've seen now from above the satellite imagery of ice in the Arctic, and you can see that when it's old, you know, has ice and snow on it, maybe even, you can reflect as much as 80% of incoming solar radiation, which is great, right? You're getting rid of most of that hot summer sun, most of that solar energy. If you've got open ocean, it's more like you're reflecting 5%. I didn't even bother to draw the outgoing arrow because you're taking in 95%. If you've got young, thin ice, and it varies, it depends how much surface water's on it, how thick it is, there's a lot of range here, but it's around 30%. Gets reflected. So it's almost as bad as open ocean, and that means it melts faster and it's doing a less good job of reflecting the summer sun. So here was the insight, right? I'm actually an inventor by trade, an engineer inventor, and I love to solve problems. And the insight was, what safe material could you use in the right spots in the Arctic to boost its reflectivity? That was the question I asked myself back starting in 2006, 2007, and finally started Ice 911, got it incorporated in 2008. And it as a nonprofit, California nonprofit, and let's see, yeah. So the material, this is why I need my camera on so I can show you. Yeah, the material is this basically white reflective sand-like material. Called hollow glass microspheres. I've tried many materials on starting on a lake in California, Serene Lakes, where I had permission from the water district through some connections to actually try some materials out there. And I'll be showing you some pictures of other places that we tried. But one thing I concluded from working there was that using sheets, which is the obvious first thing to try, seems everybody tries that from Swiss glaciers to, you know, anything like this, they're really impractical. It's almost impossible to nail them down. The wind will take them. I've always felt when I was going up there for the one day I could break out every week or two to go survey my test site, that I was looking at some CIS crime scene of, oh, I can tell the body shifted, but when? How on earth am I going to get data out of that? So they're tough. And I went to then the idea of granular materials. It's just not showing up much against this virtual thing, maybe against me. Just this white sandy material is a very common commercial product. It's very safe. It's mostly silica, which is one of the most abundant materials on Earth and in marine ecosystems. So it's a pretty safe thing to use. And millions of dollars have been spent on its toxicology over time. So that's what we're using. That's the magic, a thin layer. And what we're aiming for is hair's width thickness. So these are intrinsically, you know, some tens of microns, big enough you're not going to inhale them, but, you know, thin enough that you can really get a nice reflectivity boost. We've measured this on ice, on a pond in Minnesota especially. And, you know, you don't have to put much material there, which is mostly gas inside. It's a very thin shell of silica glass around this hollow core to make a big difference. So that's the magic. Here was Serene Lake. Here was one of my my very first volunteer besides myself. I volunteered for a long time. I called it my inconvenient hobby. Satish Chetty is an instrumentation specialist. He still volunteers with us sometimes. And there's me in my cowl hat and Serene Lake. And here's Bill Quesnell, who's with the water district up there. And we were trying to, Satish had designed and started setting up instrumentation buoys for us so that we could see what happened through the melt. Very exciting stuff. You can see some of the sheets I tried early on. And just what this all looked like. So that was a really interesting time. And it took shoestring funding to do it, so it's and it took long days. Usually I was going up there alone. You know, as I say, once every week or two when I could get a chance to get away and see how the test site was doing. Basically just trying to prove to myself, does this work? This was the concept, as you can see. I made early sketches of, well, maybe I'll have rafts of this floating on some open water and reflect sunlight away. There's a kayak and a pasted in polar bear. And there I am working on a lake in Minnesota when we got permission to work there. We got some really solid data sets out of this lake. It was in the backyard of a retired PhD chemist who was also extraordinarily handy with tools and who had, I mean, he's just wonderful, had a lot of time that he was willing to give to us. And these were my favorite boots. We're giving you the personal story there. These were called Joan of Arctic. They were the only pair REI had left before I was starting to go up to these Arctic conditions, things where I'd be outdoors all day. And they happened to be in my size and on sale. So my Joan of Arctic's a very fun thing. And you can see we were trying sheets. We were trying different kinds of particles. This was the homeowner. This was his good friend from work. They had what they called a flying albedometer. We had a great time. These are unimaginably fun and hard work things we did. And this was what happened underneath one of these sheets. When the melt came, it had preserved underneath it very well. I had chosen a kind of sheet that had the same kinds of characteristics that these hollow glass microspheres do. And there it is again, you know, with a solar powered but battery backup type of sensor buoy. And there we were. So Satish was helping me there, Tony, Doug, myself. Good times. You never know who you're going to meet, who you're going to get to know. Here's some more of our team. There's Satish again, the climate modelers we work with, Alex, our principal engineer, Steve Zornitzer, who's still on our board and was our interim executive director for a while, good old me. And what we were finding was that just a thin layer of this, you can see how much it reflected, increased the reflectivity of the ice versus untreated areas. And engineers are always going to go for control, untreated areas versus treated areas, so we can see what's the difference we made. And so there's some more of that. And then I'm segueing, so this is all Minnesota, but then I'm segueing up to Alaska. Alex came on while we were still doing some experimentation in Minnesota, and then when we were really getting going up in Alaska, up at Barrow or Utqiagvik, they've changed back to their old name. And we were putting in more buoys. Satish was helping. Another couple volunteers were helping. And Alex and I, by now, I think we're actually on staff. And, you know, you're up there sometimes when it's just completely dark, most of the time. So it's, but incredibly beautiful. You know, I found myself once, as I've been encouraged to do, the personal story is going to be in here too. I remember once thinking, oh, I'm getting sick with a cold. November? Oh, it's light only 2 hours a day. What nobody had told me was that it was basically this so many hours of twilight. of just gorgeous twilight. And the people who live up there, Michael Thomas in particular, one of the Inupiat people who live there and work for UIC Science, taught me to drive a snowmobile so I didn't have to be somebody's passenger always. And just driving out there into this incredible beauty with, it turned out, an ice rainbow that I was driving towards to get out to this test site. One of the best experiences of my life. Somehow my nose stopped complaining. So we have had a lot of time. Yeah, this is with some of the UIC people helping us. And full circle. Here's my youngest son who came up and volunteered with us. So I got to share snowmobile rides with my little guy, my backpack in place buddy there. And that, he's now in college. And that was just a real treat as well. Yeah, there's Vangelis and Alex, I'm suspecting. And we got, oh, there's Harvard, yeah. We got friends of the people in the Minnesota Pond had contracted with a seed spreader agricultural company to alter their machinery so that we could spread our materials out, not by hand anymore, as we've been doing on the small pond in Minnesota, and it started in Barrow doing, but instead dragging it behind snow machines. And that worked really well. And so there we were. Well, that's a former Stanford student of mine who decided he had to come up and volunteer. So we had a lot of fun getting these things set up and getting to see on this lake where we had permission. This is a frozen lake, North Meadow Lake up there. We got to see that we could in fact slow the melt. There I am putting out stakes because as we're deploying our materials, they're about the same appearance as the snow. So you've got to kind of stake where you've been in order to keep track. So that's some of the field work we've done to just confirm, does this work? The thing that's making our case to the world is climate modeling. And we've been working with professional climate modelers. I pointed them out to you in the pictures a little bit before. And what they're finding are profound results. We are about to submit this peer-reviewed paper, the second one on this work, and concentrating on climate modeling mostly, because that really is where the world gets to see what impact does this little shift in albedo or brightness have for the world. And it's looking profound. We tried over the Fram Strait, that area of a lot of ice export, a teeny, teeny part of the Arctic Ocean of potential sea ice up in the Arctic. And it looks like we can get a pretty good impact. We already have a peer review paper published on, you know, carpeting the Arctic, which is what we would never want to do. I don't want to be involved in trying to shift an entire ecosystem at once. That would be silly. Very risky is my assessment, even no matter how safe we think it is to start. You would never want to start that way. But doing the smallest leverage deployments we can, it looks like you can have impacts beyond your own small area. So here's Fram Strait is one area that's been climate modeled, looks very promising. The whole point is we don't want to carpet the Arctic. It would be ferociously expensive, and we don't want to run any ecosystem risk of doing something that isn't small and reversible and localized. And then this is the Beaufort Gyre, the historic nursery, where you saw most of that bright ice to start in that video, is another area. We're going to actually get, we're raising the funds to get the modeling done to do an Arctic survey to really see what are the most impactful areas, what's the right size, what really makes sense. We're also raising money to go ahead and check out the, make sure there's no impacts to the ecosystem itself. We know the toxicology itself is good, but what are the impacts to the ecosystem? Are we going to favor one species over another? We don't think so because our concentrations are low compared to what's already there, but let's make sure, because we really have a mission of first do no harm. It's very important. So our research process is this, right? We're modeling, we get permits always, we're very transparent. We deploy, we monitor, we publish. But we also need to get the world to understand that action needs to be taken and to establish some kind of regulations for this that are external to anybody pushing or exploring a particular option. And that's incredibly important too, and it's part of why we go speak at Arctic Circle Assembly or the UN, is to get that. So our mission and timeline, this is a lot of words, but the idea is that we're working to use ice restoration that has been accelerating climate change to use it instead as a lever to slow global temperature rise. to give the world time to do that really important work of transitioning from the carbon-based economy. Right now, we're the farthest ahead. We're the most studied Arctic ice restoration effort in the world, which is amazing when you know how hard we've worked for how long and with initially how small funding. But that's what we're doing. We are a determined team. And we really need to get the questions answered within 5 years so that we could do a partnered handoff to some external body to decide if this is in the best interest of humanity and then get the funding and the permissions to do that. And to help establish a framework for international implementation. And the most important operating principle here is first do no harm. You know, of course, we're trying to do the most with the least, be accountable, transparent, get permissions, be scientifically rigorous always, and to be working in partnership with everybody who cares, right? Especially the indigenous local people, also the regional global communities, the UN, the Arctic facing nations. Our plan right now is really becoming very solid because we know we're in a hurry. We've got enough of the fundamentals done that we can see this can work. But now we've got a lot of just detailed work to do. And a fair amount of this is being done with volunteers, which is not a long-term stable situation. We really need the funding to be able to accelerate and solidify that. And these five areas that you see, material performance, effectiveness in the field, safety, climate modeling, and international partnerships, really then let us say and communicate better to potential funders what we're doing today, why it matters, and to start listing proudly our partners. Like these are the folks we work with up in Barrow, Reykjavik, our native corporation. Some really exciting partnerships with the Norwegian ecotoxicologists and fate studies people, NASA Earth Exchange to help out on the climate modeling, the supercomputing resources and such. So there's a lot that's going on, and we have a new executive director who's just started a few months ago, just before the pandemic hit, who is really helping us get in shape to be able to reach out for institutional funders. I will say, looping back to Nunart, my initial most passionate supporters and most loyal donors turned out to be people I was working with at the schools, including a really steady volunteer for Nunart. And that's just been a wonderful community thing. I think Portola Valley has been my co-founder, you know, from the beginning, and Woodside people have done an awful lot to help us along as well. It's now time to appreciate the heck out of our major individual and family foundation donors and to bring on institutional fundraising to get us to the next level that we need to go. And we've got a great leadership team in place here. We've got this is one of our original board members. I'm the other one. And this is our interim ED of a year or two ago, is now our vice chair. And Tom is really, he's doing a nice job as executive director. And we're listing more and more of, you know, all the places that we collaborate with, which is, I think, helpful to people as they think about whether we're for real enough to help us get this moonshot off the ground. Because this is what we've realized, especially with our NASA people helping us, we are a moonshot. It really is an enormous lift still to get ourselves up to the partnership, to the proving, and then the partnership to get to the larger scale deployment. You know, is that 1 or 2% of the area of the Arctic in the right spot? Maybe. To be able to make the difference that we need to make in time to stabilize global climate and give ourselves time to make that transition to decarbonize the economy. So what's our shared future? I hope some of you will think about checking out my Stanford class and getting a broader education on engineering, entrepreneurship, and climate change just through listening to some pretty cool guest lecturers who tend to be kind enough to come. Well, we don't have to turn away auditors ever, so write me if you need that. And then for more information to support us or volunteer, you know, here's how to get hold of us. And it really is true that every degree matters and every degree is worth fighting for. And now is the time for the rest of the questions, I think. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Leslie. That was very informative. We do have some great questions here. I want to make sure we have time to get to them. We have one from Susie who asked about countries that like the lack of ice. She's suggesting Russia for navigation. And can you make something biodegradable, a polymer with perhaps 180-day half-life or carbonate?
Oh, those are nice questions. And I've got good answers too. So Russia was one of the first speakers I heard at that first Arctic Circle Assembly. And it was the Russian ambassador. And it was really frightening because I hadn't realized there were such outspokenly vested interests in wanting the ice to be gone. It's very convenient for their military. It gives them access to more oil and minerals. And, you know, that's the perspective of a lot of people there. My personal view is I think that if we're going to try to fight shipping interests, if we're going to try to say, no, the entire Arctic must be frozen and therefore you can't ship anything through, we're probably doing it wrong because we're going to be up against enormous economic forces trying to say, no, we will go through. But I think if you have limited shipping routes, if you have controlled shipping routes that make sense, that can allow, you know, Europe to Asia trade, for instance, at far less GHG emissions, you know, that's probably a very efficient thing to do. So I think it's going to, like most things seem to be in this life, a balance. As to the materials, I deliberately chose something that was hydrophilic, which is like glasses and silica and not plastics. And thank you for asking that because that helps me make an important point. Critters eat stuff in the ocean, and nanoplastics are getting a very bad name for all kinds of reasons, you know, stemming from that they are intrinsically dangerous, poisonous, but they also have an affinity for oil. So any oil-based pollutants are going to glom onto those as well and then come in at the bottom of the food chain. I wanted something that was going to be, and so those are hydrophobic materials. They don't like water. I wanted something hydrophilic for a few reasons. One is once it gets wetted, it's going to stay in place. It's not going to blow away again unless all the snow around it's blowing too. And one is that it's not going to have any particular affinity for oil. So if you go ahead and eat this stuff, it's going to be like birds, you know, deliberately eat gravel. It's a harmless thing rather than pulling a poison in with it. If you wanted things to break down deliberately, that you can do with a hollow shell of glass around a gas core. We could build them thin. They come in many grades right now from several vendors. You could build them thin. You could build them, you know, you could even build them a little bit porous. There's a lot of ways you can make that happen if that's what you want to do. I also see a question that came to me privately of why is the Arctic a leverage point? And that's very interesting. Temperature increases, especially in the Arctic, as Arctic ice melts. You'd expect that. It's an Arctic amplification. But it also increases temperature worldwide because those oceans talk with each other and the air talks with each other. That is, they circulate. And so if you've warmed ocean in the Arctic and it's flowing, you know, back into the Atlantic, or Atlantic is flowing into the Arctic, you've got some temperature exchange, some heat exchange going on through the oceans. You also have it going on through the air. So yes, the Arctic is warming faster than anywhere else, but it's also sharing that warmth. Are there any other questions? Those are all I see.
Yes, we have a question about how thick a layer of spheres and what happens when it snows on top of the pellets.
Ah, yes, excellent. So the spheres that we've used most often, I don't know why I'm waving this jar, you can hardly see it anyway. And the ones that we've used most often have been around 60 micron average diameter. And we have been using nominally 5 layers thick, so about 325 micron thick overall layer has been what we've been aiming for. And that is just a few hair's widths. And the idea is to use as little as you can while you're getting the maximum boost in reflectivity you possibly can. So that works, and that turns out to be a rather small amount of material for what you're doing. What was the next question? Because there was another half of that you said.
Snow. When it snows.
Yeah, thank you. Snow, of course. Snow, you can hardly do better than snow. What some of those initial sketches we flew by earlier were ones where I'd been thinking about, what if you had a raft of some sort of material? And, you know, was working my way towards the idea of hollow glass microspheres. If you had a raft of that and it snowed and it stayed there, you know, rather than dissolving into the ocean, wouldn't that be a win on reflectivity? And what we found is that snow is great, you know, either on top of sheets or on top of these materials, these granular materials. We found that, yes, snow reflects things away for quite a while, and then when it finally melts, then you're down to the materials that you've put there in the first place. These materials are deliberately chosen to float. I put a lot of time into what material I wanted to use. And that allows them to then keep protecting the layer of water under them, the meltwater that's under it, until everything melts and then things start floating around freely. And so what we found on the Minnesota pond, where we had an opportunity, pretty easy conditions to observe things, you know, early morning, late night, we could watch through those freeze-thaw cycles as things melt and refreeze in the Minnesota melt season. So it's sort of like, you know, breeding fruit flies, right? Many, many cycles in short time. And you could see the ice really getting preserved preferentially where you had these materials. It really helped. You know, it's always an advantage over the area where those materials are floating over it.
Okay, we have one last question for you.
Aha, and I think we're just about at time, so how perfect was that?
Yeah. Somebody okay. was asking if you were a fan of Kurt Vonnegut, and that's why you picked the name of Ice 911.
Yeah, you know, not many people get that. I'd say about 5% of the people I've talked with over the years get that, you know that. They look at me like, did you know? Yes, yes. And I will explain to you and give you the big reveal, part of the big reveal, the teaser, that we're about to change our name. Ice 911 has been a fabulous name for us. It told us we were working on ice and it told us it was urgent. But what we've come to learn, actually starting with former President Grimson, is 911 doesn't mean much in the rest of the world. And if you've ever worn a t-shirt that says ice on it in an airport or out in public, you'll find in the US, you'll find that it means something different to people now than the icy stuff in the Arctic we're trying to save. So we have a new name coming. But Ice 911 itself contains, yes, a literary reference. I believe it's Cat's Cradle, Kurt Vonnegut. And it has a prayer and a warning, because in there was a different phase of ice, ice 9. And if you had it, and if it was in touch with water, it would turn it into ice 9 as well. So it's like, wow, you could freeze up. How wonderful. It's self-propelling, except that if you've got something like that, it can go too far. So the prayer is that it will work and help, and the warning is, oh, but you could go too far, which I think is a lovely thing to think about when you're trying to make a climate intervention. So I built the warning into the name. I've always been aware of, you know, right, but we've got to make sure we're doing it just the right amount. It's a perfect question. Anything else?
Well, Leslie, we've run out of time this evening, but I want to thank you again for sharing your fabulous work with us, the research that you're doing, and the impact that it's having in a positive way and making people aware of what's happening with the Arctic and the climate in general. And as you've pointed out, we'll leave that slide up. If people want more information or would like to donate to this worthy cause, the information is available. I'd like to remind everyone once again that this event is sponsored by the Woodside Arts and Culture Committee, a group of volunteers here within your community. And our goal is to provide interesting work by scientists like Dr. Fields, as well as artists. And next month, October 2nd, will be our first Friday, and we'll have a wonderful artist for that. So thank you all again for joining us this evening. And I'd like to end with this quote. Once we start to act, hope is everywhere. So instead of looking for hope, look for action. Then and only then, hope will come. And that quote is from Greta Thunberg, who also said, I thought I couldn't make a difference because I was too small. And as we've seen, we have Dr. Leslie Fields and her organization within our community and making a huge difference outside of the world that each of us live in. So it doesn't take a giant to do something. Each of us within ourselves has the opportunity to make a difference, not just in the Arctic, not just with climate change or COVID-19, but with the world every day. So thank you again for joining us. And I look forward to seeing you all next time here on a First Friday event. Thank you. Have a pleasant evening.
Let me just say my thanks again to you all. This has been a really nice experience. Thank you, Tom, Kit, Corinne, Lisa, whoever else is involved. I really, and all of you who've attended. Thank you so much.
Good night. Be safe, be well.
Take care.